Welcome, everyone. It's great to see you all here. We're feeling surrounded, which is great. I was going to say that we were the kind of breakout group from Parifoto, you know, the post-photographic breakout group, but I think Parifoto is the breakout group from us. We've done very well here, so it's great to see you all here. A short introduction from me. My name's Duncan Forbes. I'm one of the directors at the Photo Museum. I've got three colleagues with me here this evening, Thomas Zelig, Marco Demutis, and Doris Gassett. We're going to have a drink afterwards, so I hope you'll have a chance to speak to them. It's great to see so many of you here. We're here really for two reasons. First of all, to listen to the views of our distinguished panel here this evening on the subject of post-photography, and I'm hoping you guys will also have a chance to ask questions. I want to come back to the panel in a minute. But we're also here to mark the inauguration of a special prize that we have launched at the Photo Museum called P3, the Post-Photography Prototyping Prize. There are a lot of P's in Post-Photography Prototyping Prize. I think there's maybe six altogether. But there are three concepts, which is why it's called P3, Post-Photography Prototyping and Prize. And over the last two or three years at the Photo Museum, we've made a big investment in dealing with issues around post-photography. I think it's been very clear to me for some time that museums are at some kind of tipping point in relation to digital media and the transformation in photographic media. And we've made a really substantial investment in the museum in engaging with this topic. We've changed our program. We have, for example, a kind of post-photographic research laboratory called Situations, which you can follow online and also in the museum itself. We've changed the infrastructure of the museum. We've built a state-of-the-art digital asset management system. We've changed the visual identity of the museum. We've changed the personnel of the museum. We have a digital curator now in the museum. And we've made a real attempt to engage with very contemporary issues in photography. Some of you, I'm sure, will know our famous blog, which also occasionally touches on issues around post-photography. We have a great blogger at the moment, by the way, Nicholas Merzhoff, who's been writing about the American election. And as part of this transformation, we have launched with our partners, the Julius Baer Stiftung, P3, the Post-Photography Prototyping Prize. And the idea of this prize really is to generate visibility for artists working in post-photography and also to offer them some very modest financial support in order to develop their work. And we're very interested in the idea of the prototype. This prize is a kind of developmental prize. We're offering money to artists to develop ideas with us and to take them to some kind of finishing point. We had about 50 artists present portfolios to us. We narrowed them down to a shortlist of five, and the artists which you see here and the work projected are the five shortlisted. I just want to mention them to you, first of all. But I do, before I say that, I just want to say a big thanks to our partners in this project, which is the Julius Baer Stiftung, very significant Swiss foundation, which supports the arts. They've had a long engagement with photography, and it's greatly to their credit that I think they're looking forward in relation to photographic practice and not just backwards. So I'm not going to talk too much about the artists. You see their work in this loop behind you. If you want more information about them, you can go onto our website. But the five shortlisted artists are Faith Holland, who's developed a project called Plastic Pixels, which dissects the portraiture of stock photography to reveal the extent of its manipulation. It's a project that kind of unveils, if you like, the different layer of the kind of stock portrait. Brenna Murphy, an artist who's done a project for us called Domain Wrap Extrude, and her prototype is really a kind of photographic sculptural installation that exists across both virtual and physical space. She uses virtual reality technologies to explore these kind of intertwined and entangled spaces. Sima Museos, who's developed a technically extremely sophisticated project called Hasiatic Lenses, and this is a prototype that engages with the possibility of creating semantically segmented images, cutting them up virtually, reorganizing them, their form according to this logic of segmentation, and that's a very exciting project. Mario Santamaria, who's produced a project for us called Zero Insertion, and the prototype for Zero Insertion visualizes the consequences of a virtual world gone wrong, the moment the internet breaks down, or it ceases to transmit information, something I'm sure we all have experience of. And then the final artist who forms the shortlist is Maximilian Schmerzer, who produced a project for us called the Salon of Clicks. And this prototype challenges what Max describes as a new techno-colonialism whereby states reconstruct destroyed monuments, in particular the monuments from Palmyra in Syria, in the form of life-size facsimiles. And he explores the kind of topology of the poor image in order to subvert this kind of techno-colonial mentality which he sees emerging and very much sponsored by Western governments at the moment. So those are our five artists, five very exciting projects. We are going to select the winner and present the winner with the prize on Sunday in Winterthur. I know there's quite a few Swiss people here. If you're in the area of Zurich on Sunday and would like to come through for the prize giving, you'd be most welcome. All five artists are going to be there, so you have a chance to chat to them about their work. And that event is at 11:30 at the Photo Museum on Sunday morning. And then the winner will be revealed, and those of you that can't make it to Winterthur will be able to follow that on our website. That's enough of the prize. I want to turn to our fantastic panel that we have here this evening. What I thought we'd do is have a kind of panel discussion for about 35 or 40 minutes and then throw open the floor to you guys for another further 25, 30 minutes or so, and then we'll have a drink afterwards at the end so the kind of discussions continue. I just want to introduce you very quickly to the panel. First of all, on my left here is Joshua Chang, who heads up the Wallach Division of Arts, Prints and Photographs at the New York Public Library, and he serves as its senior curator of photography. It must be, I think, one of the dream jobs in America in terms of visual culture. Very exciting position. Prior to that, he held positions at Yale University Art Gallery. We worked with him on the Photo Museum on Robert Adams' exhibition that he did. And he also worked at the Center for Creative Photography in Tucson, Arizona. He's produced an awful lot of artists' monographs and also has been exhibiting some of the leading kind of post-photographic practitioners in the United States. Next to him is Nadine Wittelsbach, who is one of the kind of bright new stars on the Swiss scene of photography. If you'll forgive me, Nadine. She's just started as the director of the Photo Forum at Passquart in Biel in last December. She's the founder of an independent platform for contemporary arts practices called SICK, Raum für Kunst in Luzern. And she herself has been engaged very heavily with post-photographic artists and has written a lot in this area. So welcome, Nadine. Next to Nadine is David Cunningham, who is the deputy director of the Institute for Modern and Contemporary Culture at the University of Westminster in London, and a long-standing member of the editorial collective of the journal Radical Philosophy, one of my favorite journals, I have to say. It's been a kind of beacon of cultural criticism over the last 20 years or so. Published very, very widely on issues, you can dispute that up from the panel if you want. Published very widely, issues on modernism, realism, very interesting essays recently on realism, aesthetic theory, capitalist culture. And he's co-editor of a book called Photography and Literature in the 20th Century and has recently edited an edition of the journal Photographies on the relationship between photography and abstraction. I have to say it's a super interesting journal, very, very interesting essay by David in that journal on what is, I think, an extremely important contemporary topic. David is also a blogger for the Photo Museum. He wrote an incredibly interesting blog this year engaging with the work of Hito Stahl. So it's great to have him here on the panel. Next to him is Melanie Bühler, another blogger actually for the Photo Museum. It's great to have two bloggers in physical vicinity. That's really good. Melanie lives and works in Amsterdam and also in New York. She's just moved to York and is a very well-known independent curator, particularly in this arena that we're talking about. She's founder and curator of Lunch Bites. Some of you may know this very interesting series of seminars, really a kind of project on digital art and culture that included talks, discussions, and an online platform. And it took place in various cities around Europe. I saw a very, very interesting Lunch Bites seminar at the ICA that you did, which was, I had this kind of magical moment where I was sitting in the front and I looked around and everybody in the audience was younger than me. And that was one of the moments when I realized we really had to do something at the Photo Museum about the post-photographic. So that was a good experience from my point of view. Anyway, she's written a huge amount in this area, including the very interesting Lunch Bites anthology that I would encourage you to look at if you haven't done so. And our final guests here this evening are two artists from, I guess, an artist collective or duo. I guess you describe yourself as a duo. It's probably better. Called It's Our Playground. They are Camille Lehuzec and Joey Villemont. It's Our Playground, but kind of it's a kind of web-based production that takes the form of exhibitions, internet projects, displays and installations, and it kind of develops the idea of online curation as a medium in its own terms. Very exciting kind of website if you haven't had a chance to look at it. And they pursue a kind of uninhibited reflection around modes of presentation, exhibition devices, and the influence of the internet on contemporary artistic production. So that's our panel. Let's welcome them. Okay, guys, I'm going to sit down so I don't have to stand up for 40 minutes. Let's start with what is, I guess, quite an open question and maybe quite a difficult question, which is about this term post-photography, whether it makes sense or not. I think there are a lot of layered complexities there, including the bringing together of those conjunctions, post and photography. Maybe just because you're nearest me, Josh, I mean, you've been, when you're at Tucson, very involved in exhibiting Lucas Blaylock and Owen Kidd and others that kind of new kids on the block in the US. I mean, when you produced that exhibition, were you thinking that this was a new body of work that might be described in some kind of new way as post-photographic, or did you see it as a continuity of photographic representation?
That's a really good question. I mean, I think I started out actually in terms of my curatorial practice. I sort of fell into curatorial practice from being an artist, and so I've always been very interested in what artists today are engaged with, the issues that they're engaged with. And so when I was at Yale, while I was the curator there, I also took the opportunity to go one block away to sit in on the critiques that were going on at the Yale School of Art, to just kind of keep current, I guess, with the arguments. And I recognized at the Yale School a kind of tradition that was being defended. Many of you might be familiar with it. It was really a tradition that was born out of John Tchaikovsky's positions in photography, a very sort of camera lens-based formalism. And with the influx of digital technologies, there was a real, what I saw was a kind of, there was a kind of breaking point in terms of keeping that tradition current. And so I started to meet other artists who found ways around this and were engaging really deeply with the issues of what these new technologies could afford them creatively. And so not just creating things that looked like analog products, but things that really were born out of this the condition that we live in today. So when I started to think about the work of, say, Lucas Blaylock or Owen Kidd or John Lehrer, there's a number of them. There's just three examples. Many artists of that milieu practicing and talking and debating, you know, each other actively. I did see it as something that I personally needed to engage with to stretch my own positions, and also to think more broadly about the positions of the institution, which was so rooted in this kind of, you know, 20th century analog black and white tradition. So and needed to, if the institution was going to be relevant, it had to recognize what photography, what the issues were today.
Mm-hmm. And did you use the term post-photography when you were presenting this work?
I didn't.
No, you didn't. Okay.
No.
Yeah, that's interesting.
I just used work.
Okay. Yeah. Very wise, yeah. Melanie, from your position, I mean, because you've been engaged much more widely in digital art practice, I mean, how does the discourse on post-photography look to you with it from that kind of wide orbit?
So it's interesting to me that...
Can you speak into the microphone?
Oh. Yeah. It's interesting to me that I seem to be coming late to the game all the time, because first my discourse was related to post-internet, and now it's actually post-photography, which makes me wonder where that post comes from and kind of like that impetus to make everything post, if this is actually something that is specific to our time. But that might be a slightly different question. But my background is actually digital culture more broadly. So I was first interested in digital culture and artistic practices that deal with digital culture. And then I came more specifically to the question of photography and what photography might mean in this context. So all media related terms have a hard time to kind of like to to retain their validity in this digital landscape that we are currently in, because everything that is digitized is actually comprised of the same material base, zeros and ones. So if we make distinctions between different media, that can, technically speaking, no longer be upheld. So there is kind of like this, if we talk about different media and if we look at the material base of which these media are today produced, be it a film or a document or a photograph, they all come from the same source, digitized units. So what do we make of the medium? How can we talk about photography? Is a question that is very much worth asking. Because, of course, photography is not only a technical category, but also a cultural one. And I think that this is a very important point to stress, that if we look at a photograph today, we might not look primarily at a photograph in a technical sense, but we might look at a photograph in a cultural sense. We still have expectations and values, and we want something from this image that is brought to us by our conception what a photograph is. So I've talked for a little bit now, so maybe, yeah.
But it's very interesting, this idea of this certain skepticism about the relationship of post to photography. Maybe, David, I could ask you to comment on that. Because, I mean, what interests me is that there's the practice post photography, but there's also, in a sense, the condition, the post photographic condition. Juan Gilberto has written this book called The Post Photographic Condition. Obvious echoes there of, you know, the postmodern condition and or the condition of postmodernity, and all these other titles come to mind. What are you skeptical about the attribution post, or?
Yeah, I come, I guess, from a position of skepticism about all posts, unless they are kind of literally chronological, I suppose. I think I spent much of the early 2000s fighting a futile one-man war to get rid of the term postmodernism, which didn't succeed. But I think the same problem holds in a way that what one of the problems with the post is it tends to necessarily unify what it claims to be post in problematic ways. So it unifies its precedent or its other. So that, you know, the problem with postmodernism obviously was that what it ended up producing was a kind of very crude, monolithic, univocal version of modernism in order to hold the sense of the term postmodernism in place. And then what you had to do was to create proto-postmodernists. So Duchamp and Stein and Joyce, and, you know, virtually the whole of modernism would end up being strangely proto postmodern because it didn't fit in the kind of unified version. So I think the problem, or the potential problem with the term post photography, is to do the same, to suggest somehow that the preceding history of photography constitutes some kind of unified field, you know, in a way that it clearly doesn't. I mean, one obvious point would be simply to say, well, isn't cinema already post photography in some sense? I think the more interesting use of it, which would go back to the questions of media and medium, would be the thing that the post can do productively, I guess, is to ask us to reread the history of what it claims to be post, which is, as Melanie rightly says, is always cultural and social as well as technological or technical historically. So I think the interesting use of the term turns around the way in which the impacts of digitization and the computer aren't presented so much as a kind of absolute break with that preceding history, but in some way cause us to reread that history itself, you know, so that it becomes less of a kind of punctual chronological point, as if somebody invents the computer and the digital camera and then everything changes as a condition or as a practice or as an art and so on, but rather seeing the ways in which digital processes transform but also intensify or expand aspects that are there within photography. So the piece that you kindly mentioned around photography and abstraction, one of the reasons why I think the question of abstraction is interesting is to see how much the problem of abstraction is there more or less from the very beginning of photography, that the kind of anxiety around photography as an abstracting medium, so that many of the debates that we now associate specifically with the digital as problematics of abstraction can actually be shown to kind of traverse the whole history of photography, which is not to deny that they're intensified in very important ways. I think for precisely the reasons that you say, that they, what digital does as digital, and of course that's a crucial qualifier because there is no such thing as a digital image, for example, as such. The digital as such is just numbers, binary code. But the sense in which what were presumed to be the divisions between mediums are challenged by the emergence of digital forms, since they kind of, you know, the same code underlies a visual image and a piece of music, and in principle could derive or could be given phenomenological form as either of those. But that, I think, rather than seeing, well, okay, then we had mediums and now we don't, the interesting thing would be rather to say, well, okay, did we ever really have mediums in that? Well, was photography ever really a medium in that sense? So something has changed, but not necessarily as a kind of, you know, mm-hmm. a cut from a medium specificity to something where that medium specificity is then lost.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. There's a lot of issues that I'd like to come back to, particularly this idea of the relationship between sort of history and how we think of photo history in relation to the digital. But I just quickly want to ask Camille Anjoy, you guys come at this from a completely different direction, which is from a direction of practice. From working extensively with, I guess, young artists, many of them just out of graduate school and things, working in this area. I mean, what would your... what somebody once said to me, get over it. Don't even bother discussing it. Just do it. I mean, is this a fair position, or would you see... would you want to have a discussion about these bigger questions of how to position post-photography?
Yeah, well, maybe to say, before we got invited, this term... had rarely been in our mind. I think it's maybe because we call ourselves artists and we go to art school to be artists and not photographer, then it becomes something really, something a bit different. I would agree with Melanie that we found that for us it's more like photography in the post-internet era. But maybe also that was a term that was problematic when it arrived, and then we just realized, like, okay, let's stop focusing on debating what it is and just talk about it. Mm-hmm. So for us, quite fresh, this thing. But you want me to talk about more of the practice and, like...
Yeah, I mean, what forms of practice? Let's move into that, because that's really interesting. What forms of practice are you confronting in your kind of curatorial work?
Well, with the photography.
Yeah.
Well, that's what we're talking
let's
about.
Let's stick with photography for now, yeah.
But it's more like people using, well, we could talk about us, but we could talk about other people as well. It's more like the way people treat their files, because now photography is more like files than like paper. So it's really digital, and what you do with it. I think that was a big step when people started using like softwares, but now it's more like, oh, I take this, I blow it up, and then I print it, and then I rescan it, and I blow the file, and I put it in a 3D thing. There is a lot of back and forth between medium. For us, it's more of a way of using pictures and images from other people and then using as material, like in some way, distorting them, or then using as they are, putting effects on them, effects that would be like the same as our memories and is a Photoshop filter in some way, and then transforming it. So I think there is a lot of freedom, and there is a lot of, you just use what you see in front of you and then do something interesting with it.
And how does it play across physical and virtual space for you? Because, I mean, your website is a very powerful tool, I have to say.
I think we use a lot of images that have been taken for real and not a lot of images that are like post photography in a way. Like people have made special, like we use a lot of images that exist, they all exist as JPEG, but they are not coming out of a software, like they're not being made as from Photoshop, for example, or from Illustrator. Mm-hmm.
I think what you mean, though, with post-photography is not only kind of like photography that comes after photography. It can also include photography, like photographs taken with a digital camera, right? Mm-hmm. It just kind of like acknowledges the technological embedding of photographic images,
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Can I ask Nadia, I mean, you're curating in this area, tremendous challenges now in terms of the variety of photographic media. I mean, this is something we confront at the Photo Museum and the installations we do. Can you comment on that? I mean, what sort of challenges have you confronted as when you install shows?
I think because of my curatorial practice, who was all for the longest time not related to sort of a heritage in terms of having a collection, we were always forced to establish a dialogue with the artists we were interested in working with. So we constantly had to adapt our curatorial strategies, the way we sort of establish a discourse, because of not having sort of resources to go back to. Or we were studying the history, like, of whatever, of like, of the arts or of literature, but it was always sort of focusing what we were confronted with. So what actually changed to a large part is that because of the technological aspects of work I have shown or I'm about to show, we need a lot more sort of knowledge from the outside. We need like external experts who are primarily not only dealing with the arts, let's say, I mean, programmers or people who have a very particular knowledge. So it's always sort of translating the knowledge to our needs and finding the solutions on a technical base to actually, in the end, have a space where you can experience a vision or an artwork. So I think this has changed, but not as, I couldn't say that, okay, like since like 8 years or since like 5 years, this has been a huge issue. It came sort of like this, really like almost a tender infiltration of the practice. And I believe that it's a chance to reflect upon the way we think about shows and about formats and about maybe also about the future of how institutions could function.
Do any of you have any comments about the way the image is changing? Because I'm so struck by the way that the photographic image is changing in the way it's presented by artists and by people curating from the internet. There seem to be a huge range of issues about the way the image moves on constantly now. You know, it doesn't really have a fixed form quite so much. You know, and I mean, there are still attempts by artists to fix the forms, but there is this constant mobility in the image. There's this concentration on presence much more, you know, rather than a kind of the photographic image in some way immobilizing the past. The photographic image seems a much more present form now in the way that it kind of constantly shifts across screens and platforms. Do any of you have any sense or feeling for the way that the image itself is changing?
No, I mean, I know, I'm pretty sure we don't want to go too far into this particular topic, but I have the impression it gets very complicated when the market is taking part of this discussion and of the influences the market has on artistic practices. Mm-hmm. And I mean, this can be, it's very challenging, and for the most part, it's also very different. Europe is very different to the States, or at least to my experience. And I think, yeah, in these terms, the tempo of how things are changing, how artistic practices are changing, sometimes it's like the art market like putting in punches and maybe slowing it down for some parts of the process.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else want to comment on that? Anyone? I mean, because one of the things that strikes me is the image is much more data now. It's very interesting that with the P3 prize, we've got artists who are intervening at the level of software. They're intervening in the, if you like, the kind of program of the photographic apparatus. I mean, to some extent, that's always happened, but it seems to me to be a very interesting development. And you're also very reliant on network now as well in a way of making the work. You know, networks are made through networks increasingly. And these seem to me, again, there is a history of the network in photography. It goes back to the 19th century, but it's a different kind of network.
There's also a history of networking art, of course. I mean, one of the interesting things here is the very old question of the relationship between photography and art. And here, I suppose, the question of the relationship between photography as art and the very widespread general use of forms of photography in art that wouldn't necessarily describe itself as being predominantly photography or necessarily be thought of as the kind of the central objects of something like a photography museum or institution. I think one of the things that's quite hard to disentangle here, or that's quite enigmatic to me, is the degree to which, and perhaps it comes back to the relationship between technical and cultural forms and the interweaving of those histories, so that the emergence of ideas of curating, of networking and so on, which seem in some ways related to the specificities of digital media and what happens to the image and what can be done with the image, but of course also run in parallel with the whole history of post-conceptual art since the 1960s, which has also been tied up with all of those kinds of things, and work as forms of curation, as forms of archiving, networks, research as art, and so on. You know, so that it does seem to me that it, at the very least, one can't ground it solely in the kind of technical development or the kind of realization of the possibility of the technical element. It is the intersection of those history, particularly where you're talking about photography in art, as it were, rather than the development of photography as itself a kind of, again, a kind of more or less medium-specific, quote-unquote, artistic practice.
Well, let's just think a little bit about the changing function of the artist or the changing kind of character of artistic practice, because, again, there seem to me to be shifts that are going on in terms of... and, again, it's very interesting the way it's presented, and some accounts of post-photography, they want to kind of re-entrench the idea of the artist. I think Charlotte Cotton did that in her book, Photography is Magic. Others are wanting to make the artist a much more dispersed figure. The artist becomes a kind of collector. The artist becomes a kind of archivist. Certainly the transformation in the kind of internet as archive has made a tremendous difference to artistic practice. I mean, Josh, do you have this feeling that the artists will be working differently and behaving differently?
Yeah, absolutely. And just going back to how, say, photographs have been used in art, I've been thinking about this quite a bit in my new role at the New York Public Library, because I've been getting to know this collection. It is massive. And you know, one might ask, okay, why does a library have a collection of photographs or a collection of prints? And it's in large part because from the very beginnings of the New York Public Library, there was this demand for a repository of images that wasn't necessarily, you know, high art, fine art, that weren't paintings, sculptures, that were more print media, that had a kind of that were made to circulate. And so, and of the, you know, 600,000 photographs, the 300,000 prints, and you know, million books that focus on art that have imagery at its as their core, I'm finding one of the most interesting collections at the NYPL is something called the Picture Collection. And it was founded in 1915. It was the brainchild of a woman named Romana Jawitz, who needed to find a solution to this demand by people who would come into the library, artists, architects, designers, to find specific images, not by artists, but just types of images, categories of images. So pretty soon she had had employed something up to 40 librarians who were artists, clipping images from the popular press and filing them according to this very complex file system. I think there was 12,000 different categories. Some of you might be familiar with this collection by this recent project that Taryn Simon did, kind of intervening, you know, within it. But in fact, it had been used by artists all along. Diego Rivera referred to this this database of images for his murals. Andy Warhol, the myth goes, the legend is that he checked out a few thousand of these pictures, and he used to actually be able to check them out like books, but that he checked out a few thousand images and never gave them back, and they've since made it into his artwork, those time capsules. Joseph Cornell, I mean, the list goes on of artists who have used, you know, these images as reference. You know, it's kind of a proto Google image search, and so I'm very much interested in there was never really a hierarchy there. You could have a Edward Weston picture there, or a Walker Evans picture, and something by anonymous, you know, etcher, and but you know, flattened by category and flattened by just one librarian's notion of what was interesting.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Melanie, what's your view on the changing role of the artist in this digital art period?
Yeah, I wanted to comment on something you said about the role of art within this post-photographic moment, if we call it that way. So one needs to realize that if we look at artworks online, it's through photographic documentation, which means that photo documentation has become extremely important for artists. That is, this particular image category, which is a photograph, has kind of like had a rise in recent years. And then another point I wanted to make was the role of the artists in this post-digital or post-photographic landscape is one that needs to be many things. Because with the computer, you actually have a little mini institution for yourself. You're able to have your own archive, to manage your own archive, to be in charge of the documentation of your work, to work on the documentation of your work so that it looks good, and to distribute and publish your art online. And so the artist is kind of like this entrepreneur that needs to, and he or she needs to be able to do many things and be savvy with the tools that are given at her disposal. So I think, and because work and life and work are increasingly inflecting each other to larger degrees, because with platforms such as Facebook and Instagram, these like currents constantly run through each other. This is kind of like another field that has changed, a field in which you broadcast your art and you broadcast yourself as a professional figure, but then also as a personal human being. So I think taking these things together, you on one hand side, you have a technical infrastructure with the platforms of the social web that kind of like make your life that have the potential to turn your life into a stage, and your life as a professional as well as a private person. And then on the other hand side, you have all of these tools that with which you are expected to improve your practice on so many different levels.
Can I extend that a little bit and ask Joey and Camille about the kind of social aspects of the artists you work with? I mean, one of the arguments you hear a lot at the moment is we're in a kind of post-studio environment where, you know, the artist is much more nomadic and because of the sort of technologies that are used now. And the other argument you often hear is that there's a kind of social ontology of sharing much more because of the network and the kind of speed of transmission of data. Have you noticed that in your work?
Well, yeah, I think that which is important to say is that most of the artists we've been working with for the past 7 years, we met probably all of them through documentation of their work. Like, we rarely met an artist before the install of a show. That's the world we've been working in for like as long as we've been working. I think this documentation Melanie was talking about, like this documentation of work and exhibition, became a big part of our work as artists as well as curators, because this is the window through we've seen art from the very beginning, like when we were students, basically. That's we studied in a really small town, not that far from Paris, but even though without an artistic scene, so all the work we've seen when we were students was through our computers. That's probably what led us working online at the very beginning of our practice, and having a really de-hierarchized view on the documents that we were using. And yeah, I don't know, these, like, it's quite important to say for people who don't know who we are, that we're not photographers. Like, we rarely take pictures ourselves. If we produce images, a photographer would produce them. So we're probably post-photographers in that sense. Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's also responding to the fact that now when you create an artwork, you're creating an image or a photograph because it's going to be archived in some way. And people are going to encounter the work through images and through photograph even before being able to see the work, or even before sometime the work is going to be shown anywhere. It's going to be mailed to a gallerist or to a curator, and then eventually it's going to be shown after. So these pictures better be good, or the best one, or the biggest one where you can zoom in and see all the details. And this is what also we like in picture of artworks, when you could zoom in and then you could, and then your screen's got just a little part of the work and it becomes something else. If you look through, it's becoming you, could become a painting, or could be something else.
But I mean, David, just to kind of pick up on a point you made earlier, I'm very interested in these links that you're making back to the 60s, for example, and I like this idea that there might be a kind of long wave of development in these arenas, but there is something very different about the current period. You know, this is a post-crisis society, post-2008, we're now in another new crisis.
Post-Trump now.
You know, and with tremendous precarity in Western Europe. In particular, with a lot of artists living really in very impoverished conditions, having to do multiple jobs, for example. I mean, it's one of the interesting things about the artists we confront Vinter increasingly, you know, the role of the photographer has vanished, let's face it. I mean, they're doing all kinds of graphic design jobs and things to keep themselves going. So there are differences, aren't there, between, you know, the kind of post-war welfare states, support for artists, and the complete sort of vanishing of that in parts of Western Europe.
Yeah, no, I mean, I suppose I was thinking about... when I was talking about the difference between photography as art and photography in art in that sense, I was thinking, well, someone like Warhol would be exemplary of that. I mean, an artist who is impossible for the most part without photography, but who we don't think of primarily as a photographer. I mean, we don't think of that as art photography. A horrible term, but it doesn't... as opposed to, in a sense, what you're talking about, which is really interesting, but in some ways it's a kind of... it's quite a traditional sense of the photograph's relationship to the work, isn't it? Which that you're accessing the real work in some way through the photograph. That it's now on a screen. You're able to do a whole series of things with it that you couldn't before do, like, you know, zooming to incredible high definition. But in some ways, there's still a distinction there between the idea there is a work out there, an installation or something, and then there is the photographic documentation of the work. What seems, which in a way doesn't seem that kind of post-photographic. In a sense, post-photographic would seem to be the point at which that distinction, I guess, disappeared. Yeah. Which I suppose practically for most people it does, and that comes back interesting because, of course, most of us do all the time see art now through screens. And in terms of things like appropriation, of which again there is obviously a very long artistic tradition. Some of which relates to photography, some of which doesn't. That has clearly been massively transformed by digital media, and within those larger economic and social situations of precarity you're talking about is clearly key to that process of the simple ease of access. I mean, you know, it's hard not to immediately fall back into the kind of cliches of discussing this stuff, but. The accessibility of imagery via the internet and on the screen allows you to do incredibly cheaply what would have been a very labor-intensive process of going to the, you know, right. I like the idea of actually checking out the photographs, you know. Well, you know, obviously we go on Google Image, we do that. One interesting thing, going back to your point about past and present, is I think interesting in that regard, because that does seem to be about a temporality of sharing itself, which is by no means specific to art, but which has interesting artistic consequences in some sense, which is, I think you're right that the philosophical discourse of photography in particular always has been about it as a form of memory, a form of the kind of the preservation of the past and so on. What's going on with things like Instagram and uploading a photograph that you take in the process of making a tweet on your camera on a mobile phone is an entirely different kind of temporality. Which becomes much more about a kind of narration of the present rather than a narration of the past in some sense, isn't it? And I think that then takes the forms of the network, the conversation. Somebody, again, the kind of cliche, somebody putting up, this is what I'm having for breakfast, This is not about, oh, remember when I had that for breakfast 10 years ago? This is what I'm having for breakfast now, and here is now immediately the kind of the image. So that, I think, is clearly now working its way into certain kinds of artistic practice and changing those kind of networked forms, in part just because the temporality, the pace has changed. I mean, think of the difference between this and something like mail art, which, which wasn't so long ago. You know, you sent something in the mail to somebody and then they did something and they sent it back. You know, that's a kind of network, it's a kind of communication form, it's participatory and so on, all these things. But at a phenomenological level, it's entirely different because of the sheer speed that's involved in it, that you can get much closer to a seeming instantaneity of, you know, this is what I'm doing now, and here is the image.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
I think it's interesting to consider photographs as a form of communication that is much more widespread now. And I think it's interesting for a photography museum then to think about what that means in terms of image literacy, because everybody, we're so, nowadays, everybody's so used to take pictures that, and it has become such an ingrained form of communication that I wonder if this means that if our forms of communication about pictures, about images, needs to change as well. Mm-hmm. And that's actually an interesting question for me, for a photography museum, you know, mm-hmm. How do you engage with an audience that is so literate in nonverbal forms of communication, in image-based forms of communication? And it's also interesting that all of the platforms that are so prevalent now, Instagram and Facebook primarily, are image-based. And Twitter, the only big platform that is still text-based, is slowly running out of users. So this kind of like shift in communication is also an interesting part of what we might call post-photography. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, that raises an awful lot of issues around, I mean, Boris Groys, for example, has argued there's a kind of non-identity in the image just because there are so many images. Mm-hmm. And the role of the museum is to, what he calls, to kind of cure or curate that situation. And that's the kind of response, that's in part how we would see our role, I think. I want to throw the open to the floor in a minute, but I do want to ask the group one more question, which is about, because I mean, you've been inching us towards institutions. And I think we're a bit careful what we say here, because this is being streamed. But, you know, what has been the institutional response to post-photography? We're lucky at the Photo Museum, we're a small museum, we can move very quickly, we've got smart people working for us, so it's, you know, we can make changes quickly, but it's not always the case for institutions. And I'm just wondering, perhaps Josh, if you could address this tricky question of the institutional response to post-photography, perhaps in the US.
Sure, well, I mean, maybe just, I'll start with my current institution, which doesn't really address it much at all. I think that, you know, the library is less of a platform than a repository. So we have to grapple with how to archive and collect and make accessible and also preserve the sort of context for the things that are being created now post-photographically. And I think in general, there's not as many Kunsthalle or project spaces in the U.S. as there is in Europe. And so I think a lot of the collecting institutions that might bestow a kind of prestige on an artist's work are also grappling with this same issue. Even though I think some of them are really making strides to be more flexible in terms of how they both collect and also create a kind of a bridge to the physical things they might have that they must care for and reinterpret, and what's happening today and what their audiences frankly demand.
Mm-hmm. Nadine, do you have any views about the? And I know you do because I've spoken to you about it. But what's your feeling about the way institutions are dealing with post-photography?
I've been thinking a lot lately about the term photographic, and about image instead of photography, or about photograph. And I think we always have to, or like right now we are about to discuss the fact that as an institution who is based in a city which with the highest diversity in this very tiny country called Switzerland, we have 150 nations and only 60,000 inhabitants, for example. Just so we're very interested in this sort of like global like discourse, but at the same time it's very important to have a gravitation to the place where we are. And we realize that one potential to have to establish a discourse on a very high level, specialized online. But we also talk about, we say discourse and art education, and art education has still this like notion of, oh, it's for the kids and for the old and the silver servers. So what we are actually trying to do is to think about images and about the photographic processes in terms of their emotional aspects. And this has, for us, it's gonna be like a very interesting sort of challenge to deal with those questions and to get them funded.
Yeah,
because I think this is the institutions we know 40 years ago or 20 years ago, they are changing drastically right now, and it's good that they are changing. But the funders and like the political structures, they sort of have to find their way of dealing with all those like new ideas. And I think it's everything is very fast, but a lot of structures are still like very heavy and slowed down. So it's going to take a lot of energy to break through those structures and actually make people understand that visual literacy and thinking about images, and especially the choices we are doing every day in choosing images, showing images, that this is going to be sort of the future of the institutions we are sort of responsible for.
Great, okay. I think we've got about 20 minutes for questions, so I'd love to hear what you guys think. There are a couple of microphones. I would really prefer it if you could use a microphone, because then it will be picked up on the recording. But does anyone have any questions, points, provocations? You need to use a microphone. There's one down here. And there's one over there. Yeah, maybe we can pass this to you, and you can start. And then there's one over there. You join the panel.
Yes, the panel on the floor.
But make sure you speak into it.
Yeah, like this. Thank you very much.
You need to be close.
Yes. Well, the discussion, I think, just started, and 40 minutes, or how long was it, is just the intro.
Yeah.
And now we have to cut off where it gets to be interesting. And I think because now we start to get a point which is that we don't, or yeah, you were not talking about the object, the photograph, but more about the relation between the one who is, or the thing, the apparatus who is making the picture, and the person or thing which is photographed. So this relation is what it's about. And what you said, that we use photographs to communicate, I think it's even more. We use photographs to appropriate a situation. That before, making a photograph was always the position of an observer, but now it's the contrary. It brings me into the situation when I make the photo. I'm not part of it unless I have made the picture and posted it and taking. And I take the situation with me and I take it home.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Is there a question over there?
Yes, hello. I'm Liz Wells. I'm one of the co-editors of Photographies, which you mentioned earlier on. Hi, David. And so I just wanted to thank you for mentioning it. I was thinking about the context specificity of this discussion. We've been talking, or rather you have been talking, in terms of artistic processes, in terms of art as object, in terms of a museum as context. And then we're talking about post-photography or post-photographer. I went to see the exhibition a couple of days ago, I think it was, of the person who's just won the Photojournalism Awards for an extraordinary and highly researched commentary on what's going on in Libya at the moment in terms of human trafficking. I think that we're in danger of forgetting that it's important to think that then post-photographer is completely inappropriate, because the authority of that body of work
rests in the fact that we trust the photographer and his research and his sensitivities and his ethical dilemmas and so on. So I wanted to make one point about the art museum really being only one context, and we shouldn't make generalized points about post-photography that relate only to a specific context. And then the other point, which has been, sorry to make two points, but which has been running through my mind, is that we've been talking about art and artists and processes, but not about the phenomenological experience of encountering work in a particular context. So that, for example, again, an example from Parifoto or from Pari at the moment, work by an artist who I know well, that I'm very familiar with, but I've only ever seen on screen, I met in the Mexican exhibition installation the other day as an installation. And it was totally memorable in a way in which it isn't when I scroll through the works that he sent me by, however he sent it, WeTransfer or something. So I think there's also the phenomenological experience of the encounter with art, which after all doesn't exist until we encounter it, if you want to chew an old philosophical bone. And that takes us back, I suppose, to the previous comment, which is we're only just beginning. There's an awful lot more that we need to talk about in order to try and get our heads around some of the challenges of the moment. Yeah, that's enough.
Any other questions? Maybe take a couple more and then ask the panel to comment. There's one here.
Okay, just a little suggestion about words. Post-photography seems like, just another step from something that has been existing for a long time. Maybe we could speak of a forward photography or advanced photography, something more like open to new horizon, or maybe our image generation. I think there is something about that new generation of photograph is about the live process. You spoke about presence and the immediacy. There is also something about a life process behind. We could speak a bit more about that. And image generation would probably be an interesting concept to speak about that.
Yep. I think Jeff Batchen about 10 years ago came up with the idea of beyond photography. And of course there's extended photography, there's augmented photography, you know, I mean there's a whole range of different terminologies. We'll have to change the name of the prize, that's the problem. That's the only problem.
Yeah, do it.
Any other questions in this round? We've had two very coherent questions here, so three very coherent questions. Oh, there's one here. Do you want, can we hand a microphone? Sorry to insist on the microphones.
One quick question. So what would post-photography be nostalgic of?
What would post-photography be nostalgic of? Let's. Does anyone want to respond to these two questions about the relational aspects of post-photography, which I think are very interesting questions? Is there anyone on the panel who would like to comment on that and the contextual aspects of what's shown and what's seen? Total silence. David, do you want to? You're waving your arms in the air.
I was waving my arms in the air. I agree entirely about the different contexts. I mean, I think, discussions about photography can too quickly become discussions about art or discussions about photography and art. And at the very least, what's most interesting there is the way in which art necessarily intersects with those other kinds of practices, and that is part of that process of artistic generation and so on, is the way in which it draws upon and critiques and changes itself in relation to other kinds of contexts. I think you're exactly right about the point about trust as well, and I think that is often overstated. I mean, that in principle, a digital camera is still a fundamentally indexical machine. You know, it still relies upon light coming into a sensor. It just does something different with it at that point. That is open to manipulation more easily than older photography was. But of course, chemical forms of photography were open to manipulation of various kinds as well. whether in terms of what you shot, you know, the famous fairy pictures, or simply manipulating the negative, or Stalin taking Trotsky out, and so on. So I think there is a difference of degree, but outside of some purer forms of CGI, you know, most photography, I agree, still relies in some sense for its charge on that, mm-hmm. that sense of a physical connection with the real. And that's crucial, of course, to its artistic context as well. I mean, going back to the point about documentation, you know, where photography is used to document art, obviously it's still being used in, you know, fundamental sense of a kind of trustworthy image of some kind. The point about the phenomenological context as well, I think, you know, that's obviously right, and it's... It's perhaps not quite the same point, but it's an important reminder, what I said earlier, that there's no such thing as a digital image per se. You know, you can't see, digital form just isn't an image, it isn't visual, or indeed oral, or whatever, it's numerical, mathematical form. So it always has to become analog. What's interesting about digital, in a way, is the range of forms of analog materializations it can take. Which are exponentially more than was the case for the chemical forms of photography, which tended to be paper-based and so on, so that it can go into, yes, a kind of, it can go onto a screen on your phone, it can go into an installation, it can go to a huge blown-up high-definition image and so on. You know, that's part of what's interesting. But each of those, of course, then has to be thought of in their specificity, which is as much a question of context as anything else. There is something fundamentally different from, you know, me watching a film on my phone and watching a film in a cinema, something in this kind of size space.
Any other questions? I think we've got time for a couple more. If not, I'll ask another question. There's one here.
We're talking about the tools, right, and about the perception. But I was wondering if the main change didn't happen in what is being depicted. As we understand photography, it's always about taking subjective pictures of things which do exist in a certain form. And what is absolutely new in the past 20 years are images which we agreed to call photographs or post-photographs of things which do not exist in a physical world. And that's something which architects in their everyday practice do for years and years. They do the so-called renderings, photorealistic renderings, which mean they create images, photographs of not existing things as a simple tool in their job. And now this way of thinking happened in an artistic scene, like on the work of the shortlisted artists, they were showing images of like their own minds, the way architects show their houses, perhaps. That could be a definition of what is post.
I think you're right. I mean, I think for me there has been a shift in some modes of art practice. Actually, that one sees that in the few works of post-photographic art and Paris photo, towards a kind of figuration, which is akin to the graphic arts. And I think photography has shifted in that direction to a certain extent. And, you know, there are both advantages and dangers in that. You know, the obvious danger is a kind of new wave of photographic formalism, although I think there are many artists refusing that, which is great to see. But no, I think you're absolutely right that these tools have enabled a kind of new processes of figuration to emerge. Don't know if anyone else wants to comment on that.
Maybe we can go back to the question about nostalgia, because that's an interesting question that maybe also touches on how institutions grapple with this new landscape and problem. And I think if nostalgia is occurring, then it's kind of like the mourning of indexicality that is most prominently alluded to when we speak about losing something, when like from this moment going from analog to digital. And I think the index has been a very powerful myth around photography that has been in place quite long. And I think it's a core value that kind of like fundamentally defines photography. Maybe to agree that doesn't correspond, maybe it's not very truthful that it has such a value, mm-hmm. but it's still kind of like a value that is strongly in place. And you just described it very eloquently that digital cameras still capture light. Like the moment of capture is still the same. But the moment of translation is different because light is no longer etching itself into a material base and making itself present in a specific material setting, but has become immaterialized, so to speak, through numbers. But then, again, and you also said that the moment of visualization still needs to be there, and that in that moment you still need to be generating something. So you still need to be like, you still need to kind of like translate that into a material format. So I think at the core of this whole discussion, what have we lost, like going from analog to digital? What has changed is this myth about materiality and immateriality is another myth that has to do with that, which is the index. And these kind of like, these form the core values at the center of it, I think. Yeah.
I'm reluctant to open up a debate on indexicality because we're going to be here till this time next year. Time for one more question. You want to ask a question? No? Okay, last question, here we go.
I hope that I can put it into terms. My question is about the, if you think that there's a general unity of the photographic. So, as somebody else mentioned, that you talked about very specific realm, reigns of where photography happens and different roles. But for me, always the question is there something which unifies all the photographic, including film, especially including automatically produced images from machines and algorithms? So I think we are like a nostalgia. We are following this idea of the photographer as an artist, as a romantic artist. No, mm-hmm. We still cannot let loose, even though it's not happening everywhere. So would you say that there exists a unity of the photographic?
I think that's a great question. It's a really great question to end on. I have a view on that, but does anyone on the panel want to engage with that?
I mean, something I think it's, again, interesting if you think about institutions or museums is like, what is the source and who is the author? Or if there is no particular author, how do we deal with those questions in an exhibition framework? And I think this question of how categorized photographs could be, it's something I'm incredibly bored by thinking at it, and at the same time, it's a necessity somehow. And I don't think that post-photography should or shouldn't summarize all those categories, but I'm pretty convinced that it sums up maybe practices of how practices or actions which can result in an image one way or the other. That's maybe, yeah, sort of a one way of thinking about it.
Yeah, I mean, there's a unity, but a unity of an odd kind, isn't there, that allows you to talk about all these things as photographic. And I think, let's say, to make an intuitive sense, to think of these things as being sharing a constant family resemblance. I mean, and of course, that's true of the photographic camera itself in its very earliest form, because actually there are a whole series of technologies that are interlinked, but substantially different in ways that we think of as, you know, the birth of photography. So I think that's that. that kind of unity of quite different practices is there in many ways from the very beginning of the history of photography. I mean, clearly there are within that then important moments of shift, and the digital is definitely one and perhaps the most important. But of course, and I was thinking back to what Melanie was saying, we shouldn't forget things like video and television, for example, which function on, again, on very different principles, because they're, again, they still rely on light and the sensing of light, but they are already scanning. It's not an inscription in the sense in which a chemical photograph is. It's discrete like digital, but it's carried by analog forms, by electrical signals. So there's a complicated history of that. I think I suppose one could put it another way around and say, well, okay, why would we think of this as any different from the unity of painting, say, given how fundamentally different the fresco is from the canvas and so on? You know, why would we think all of this is painting? Well, because we think there is a kind of continuity that runs across that history, which is partly shifting the terms of that history. And I think that's true with the photograph, that all of these technologies and the cultural forms, you know, are interacting in some sense with that history. Presumably, if they stop interacting with that history, they wouldn't be post-photography, they would just simply be something else at that point. You know, it is the sense in which there is a kind of continuity that underlies the forms of discontinuity.
Wouldn't you say that the basis for what might be conceived as the photographic is always based on an abstraction? At the beginning, you talked about abstraction. Or that no matter how any photographic process, with all its differences, is based on a function. So when I paint, it's a direct bodily expression. But all the photographic divides itself from painting by being the product, before making any photograph, of a function, of a abstraction, of a mathematical form.
That there's a program in the camera, and that's as true of chemical cameras as it's true of digital cameras. Yeah, but that might be a unity itself. I mean, that is what makes it fundamentally different from, say, the forms of image production that we do associate with painting or drawing, and so on. And although the means by which it does that is often very different, a chemical camera and a video camera and a digital camera are very different technologies in many ways, that would be part of their continuity, I would think.
Yeah. I mean, for me, if there's a unity, it's distributed amongst different kinds of photographic media. And I think one of the exciting things about the current period is it's opened that up historically much more. And one of the things we didn't discuss is the way that the current period is really transforming the potential for the writing of photographic history, and I think that that's another very exciting aspect of that. However, we are running out of air, so I'm going to call a halt to proceedings, but there will be there's some wine for us from the Centre Culturel Suisse. I'd just like to thank very much the Centre Culturel Suisse for organising this event. I'd like to thank our panel very much for being here. I'd like once again to thank our fantastic sponsors, the Julius Baer Stiftung, for their support, and I'd finally like to thank all of you for coming, and let's carry on the conversation with a glass of wine. Thank you.